Hi, in today's fuss-free, gluten-free video, we're going to be making homemade baked beans. Now, I love baked beans, they are fantastic. They're a really good source of vegetable protein and absolutely chock full of fibre. So if you can get them into your family, that is awesome. But the thing is, when you look at the tins of baked beans that you buy, they're often really high in salt and sugar. And in addition to that, it can be hard to find ones that are gluten and dairy free. So for example, the ones that we were buying, which were about the only ones I could find that were gluten and dairy free, had over 30 grams of sugar per serve. So that's like 6 teaspoons of sugar. You wouldn't put 6 teaspoons of sugar in your cuppa, so I'm guessing you don't want to have 6 teaspoons of sugar in just one serve of your baked beans, especially if you're feeding it to your kids. So I'm going to show you how quick and easy they are to make. Now when I say quick, I mean quick as in it doesn't take a whole lot of your time, but they do cook, they are a slow cooked food. So I usually make them on the weekend where I can start it in the morning and let it just simmer away throughout the day. So to get started, I've got a packet of beans here. Now I usually use cannellini beans and they're sometimes called white beans. So they come in a packet just like that. And as you can see, it's a fairly small packet, but once they're cooked, they swell right up and they make quite a lot. So I've soaked these beans overnight and you can see they're now quite plump and much bigger. You wouldn't fit all of that into that packet. So I've drained them off and I've rinsed them really, really well. Now it's really important when you're cooking with dried beans that you don't just boil them straight out of the packet. That overnight soaking process and then rinsing is really important. And that's because these beans, or because they're a dried seed, they have a natural protective mechanism that the plant puts into it, and they're called phytates. But when you soak the beans and rinse them, a lot of those phytates come out in that water. So really, really important you do it. And what those phytates do is they're one of the things that often cause wind that you get when you eat beans. So soaking them will help to reduce the wind. But also they bind to the minerals. So when you eat, you're not getting the full nutritional value out of your meal, because your minerals like magnesium and zinc and iron, they bind to these phytates and then they get passed out. So you're not actually getting the maximum nutritional value out of your food. Right, so let's get started. We've got one packet of beans here that I've soaked overnight, drained them off, rinsed them really, really well and drained them again. So we just pop them into a pot. Now you can use any kind of stock pot, but I like to use one that can go in the oven because these are going to be cooked in the oven later on. So if you can boil them in a pot that can also go in the oven, one less thing to wash up, which is always a good thing. Otherwise, just boil them in a regular pot and then put them into a casserole dish later. So we've put the beans in there and now we're going to cover them with cold water. So you want to cover them, so you've got probably a good sort of 1.5 inches of water above the beans. And really, really important that you use cold water at this point, because if you use hot water, what happens is the outside of the bean will overcook before the inside of the bean cooks through. So you'll get beans that are mushy on the outside and still hard on the inside, and they're really not very nice to eat. So I've covered them with cold water, we turn it on, up onto high, and we want to bring that to the boil. Now once that comes to a rolling boil, turn it down and simmer it. And you'll notice you get kind of a foamy scum on top, so just use a skimmer or a slotted spoon or a regular spoon and just skim that foamy scum off the top as it rises up. Now the length of time that it takes to cook the beans will vary depending on which beans you've used. So I find with cannellini beans it can take around 1 hour, sometimes a little bit longer. I made this with borlotti beans last time and they cooked really quickly. They only took about 20 minutes until they were tender. So just keep an eye on them and just taste one every now and then, and once they're just cooked through, that's when you want to take them off and drain them. So we're going to let that come to the boil now, and then once they're tender, I'll come back and I'll see you then. Okay, so these beans are just tender now, so I'm going to turn that off and I'm going to strain them. Now when you strain them off, you want to keep the liquid that they were cooked in. So the way that I do it is I get a colander and a big jug, or you could just use a big bowl if you like, and then I'm going to drain it that way. So I'll just do it over the sink because I usually make a mess. And then we're going to use this pot again. So pop it back on the heat and just a little glug of olive oil. There we go. basically just enough so that the bacon is not going to stick. So I'll turn this back on again. Alright, and we pop our bacon in. Okay, so we want to cook the bacon until it's browned up nicely and it's just starting to get that sort of crispiness to it. And then we're going to add the onion. Now I don't add the onion at the same time as the bacon because for whatever reason, if you cook bacon and onion together at the same time, the bacon just doesn't seem to brown up really well. So I like to do the bacon first and then add the onion in. Now you can use, I often use speck instead of bacon. You can leave this out altogether if you want to make a vegetarian version, but I find that it just gives a really nice extra sort of flavour to it. So I've cut that really roughly, as you can see, so it's nice big chunks. This is a really rustic meal. I mean, it was originally made by the cowboys, so you know, you don't have to worry about any fancy cooking techniques here. So we're just going to cook that down until it starts to brown. So our bacon is nice and brown now, so we're going to add some chopped onion. Now you don't have to finely dice the onion, just chop it up and throw it all in. Like I said, it's a rustic dish, so no super duper knife skills required. We're just going to toss that around and cook that down until the onion just starts to just get a hint of colour on it and it's nice and translucent. All we're really trying to do here is just get rid of that raw taste. We're not trying to cook it right down. Okay, so our onion now is nice and soft and it's just starting to get that sort of translucent, light golden brown colour to it. So now the recipe comes together really quickly. So add the garlic in. Again, just roughly chop it. It doesn't have to be super fine. And add as little or as much as you like. We really love garlic, so I'm always pretty generous here. And just mix that through. You just want to give it sort of about 30 seconds to a minute, like I said. It's just to get rid of that raw flavour and just soften the taste up so it's not quite as sharp. Now a lot of people like to put their garlic in at the same time as the onion, but I find that garlic burns really, really quickly and really, really easily. So I think it's best to cook the onion first and get it to where you want it, and then add the garlic and just give it about 30 seconds to a minute, again just to get rid of that rawness, because otherwise it just burns and it makes the whole dish taste really bitter and it's not very nice. Okay, so that's probably about enough. That's all it takes. And now we can add pretty much everything else. So, first of all, I'll add some molasses. Now, a lot of homemade baked beans recipes you'll find, they often have honey or maple syrup or brown sugar even, and that's usually in addition to the molasses. But I like just the molasses. It gives a really lovely, deep, sort of a richness to the recipe. And it's really high in magnesium, which is a very important mineral. So it sweetens it, but without making it like sugary sweet. It's a really subtle, earthy kind of sweetness. All right, and then we add some vinegar. Today I'm using just red wine vinegar because that's what I've got in the pantry. You could use apple cider vinegar. You could use just plain white vinegar, whatever you like. If you haven't got vinegar in the house, you can use kombucha instead. Just don't use malt vinegar because malt vinegar has gluten in it. Alright, so that's just starting to bubble. I might turn it down just a smidge. And then we add some thyme and oregano. Now if you've got any favourite dried herbs that you really love, like rosemary or whatever, throw them in. I mean, you know, make the recipe your own. And then we've got some sweet paprika. Oop, stuck in there. And finally a bit of smoked paprika. Now smoked paprika is a fantastic ingredient. It gives things obviously a smoky taste, but it gives that kind of barbecue hint to it that you don't need to cook things on the barbecue. Or if you want things to taste like they've got barbecue sauce in them, but you don't want to use actual barbecue sauce because they're always full of sugar and usually really high in salt as well. So a bit of smoked paprika, be careful, it's really strong. So just start with a little bit because you can always add more. Is a fantastic ingredient for anything where you want that smoky, barbecue-y kind of taste to it. Alright, so that's all mixed through and now we're going to add our beans that we've drained. Chip them in. There we go. And then we're just going to give this a good stir now just to really coat the beans in that lovely mixture. well coated. Add a pinch of salt. Now I don't add the salt when I'm boiling the beans initially because that will make them go really tough. So wait until this point before you add them. And of course if they need it you can always put a little bit more on when you serve them. And then some pepper. Okay. And then a cup of the reserve liquid that we cooked the beans in. Now if you forgot to keep it and you accidentally threw it out, don't worry about it, just use water. Or you could use chicken stock if you've got some of that. Alright, so mix that through. Actually, I might put a bit more liquid in there, just because we're going to bake these now for 2 hours and we don't want them to dry out. So it's one of those recipes where you just sort of go a bit by eye. Okay, so I've got just enough liquid in there that you can see the liquid through the beans. So we're going to pop the lid on now and put them in the oven. So we want to cook them on a really low heat. So I usually do them at around sort of 160, 170 and we're going to cook them for about 2 hours. So I take them out every half an hour and give them a stir and just keep an eye on that liquid level. We're trying to reduce it down but we don't want to dry it out completely and have it just turn into a big, big cakey mess. So if they look like they're starting to dry out, you can add more liquid, and if it looks like they're just it's staying really soupy, then just take the lid off so that more of it evaporates. So just kind of gauge it as each time you check it. So every half an hour I pull them out and I have a look. Alright, so I'll pop these in the oven and then when they're ready I'll take them out and show you. Okay, I think they should be just about ready now, so let's have a look. Oh, they look beautiful. Alright, so most of that liquid has absorbed now. There's just enough left in there to keep them nice and moist. So they're all set to serve up. Now, I usually like to serve them with a really nice crisp green salad or maybe a coleslaw. And they're great for dinner. Like I said, you can make them ahead of time and then dinner's all ready once everyone comes in. Or I'll often make a big double batch and then freeze it in small batches and we'll have them for breakfast, or if I just want something quick for lunch I can just reheat them. So just one tip though when reheating them, I usually add a little bit of extra water because they do tend to dry out a bit when they sit in the fridge or in the freezer. So just put a little bit of water in the pot and away you go. Enjoy your beans and I'll see you next time. Oh, and for the full recipe, check out my website cindyleekennedy.com. Go to the recipes section and you'll get all the quantities there. I'll see you next time.